Yeah, thank you for the introduction, and thanks a lot to the organizers to invite me. It was really funny to see my name in between all the famous people. So most of you probably won't know me. I'm Paul Ziska. Before I start my talk, I organized a guided snorkeling tour for tomorrow at 2 o'clock. It's 120 euros. We can be maximum 12 people. If you are interested in joining, please send me an email with your name and telephone number. And perhaps you could already now raise your hand if you want to join so that we can look forward to it, perhaps. Who wants to join? Okay. No. It's the entire group. And they will provide snorkeling equipment and everything. And it's Antonio told me it's a beautiful spot. It's around the corner. So, yes, I'm looking forward to this. And now my talk. So I'm dealing, I'm interested in how insects deal with these turbulent odor plumes. I think it's relevant also for mice because this is a normal way odorants distribute in the air. So animals, they encounter highly intermittent odorants, and they encounter odor filaments or odor stimuli which are very short and which rise from zero concentration to 100% of concentration within no time. Yeah, imagine you are a human walking through such a bloom, or a honeybee which flies with up to 25 kilometers per hour. That means that you increase even more temporal intermittency and turbulences. I will talk about how insects, what kind of information insects can use to separate odorants from different sources. This behavioral data constrains the coding scheme, so it poses temporal constraints on how odor information can be encoded in the olfactory system, and I will show you what are the physiological constraints of an odorant code by showing you the temporal precision of insect olfactory receptor neurons. I like to so I always show, in fact, this two odor plume picture from Antonio and Massimo's work, which nicely shows how odorants from different sources intermingle or not intermingle. So what you see is that this red and this green odorants, which are released from two nearby sources, they show correlated fluctuations. But also uncorrelated fluctuations. They overlap to a certain degree, but they also stay separated. So if you want to know whether this plume originates from one or from two sources, you have two different types of information available. One is you just sample the space, and you know that here was the red odor and there was the green odor. That would help you to solve this odor segregation problem. Or you use temporal information. Yeah, insects with their short antennae, in particular Drosophila, which have antennae which are, I think, 100 micrometer long, they don't have a spatial resolution. So they rely on temporal resolution. And this is what I will tell you today. And please remember the introduction of Andreas Schäfer, because he nicely explained this concept behind using odorant, temporal odorant structure to solve this object segregation task. And as Andreas, I also read this paper by Hopfeld, and I found it very inspiring, and so in particular the sentence, so I have to read it again. The variable nature of turbulent airflow makes such a remote sensing problem solvable if the animal can make use of the information conveyed by the fluctuations with time of the mixture of odor sources. Good. So if you are an insect with a small antenna with no spatial resolution, you need to have a good temporal resolution in order to do the source segregation. And here also comes the olfactory cocktail party, or the cocktail party analogon, in play. So when we want to solve this cocktail party problem, so when you start all talking at the same time now to me, I can use different mechanisms to separate your voices. So I can focus my attention to one voice. I hear from which directions the voices come. But there's additional information, and that is, if you start talking, then all the sounds you produce, they will arrive in synchrony, they will fluctuate in synchrony, whereas when you are talking, your sounds, they will arrive with a different temporal signature. And in fact, our auditory system uses this information, so it can use odorant sound onset asynchrony to segregate concurrent sounds. So here's one auditory example now. We have 24 sounds. They all start at the same time. You hear this. So you have heard one sound. now we delay one of the frequencies, 600 hertz, by 160 milliseconds. Now you hear this. Did you hear a difference? So you should have heard two sounds. I will play it again. Please listen. Or again. Okay. So is this a good analogy? Stimulus-wise, I think it's a very good analogy because you could think of these sounds as being odorants. Yeah, all these which start synchronously come from one source, and this one odorant here comes from another source. But is it a good analogy for an olfactory segregation mechanism? And now you have to imagine you are an insect. And so how do insects smell? The olfactory organs of insects, they are exposed to the air. So the receptor neurons, they are situated on the antennae in these sensilla. And they are continuously sampling the air. Yeah, so it's not like sniffing. Insects continuously sample the odorant stimuli, and it is in fact a bit like as our hearing. Yeah, we also continuously hear. There is no intermittency due to sniffing or so. So in theory, insects have good access to the temporal structure of a stimulus. So when we want to investigate how insects perceive and process these temporal stimulus information, we need to precisely control the odorant stimuli. And this we do with an odorant delivery device, which is capable to produce arbitrary binary mixtures, where we can let fluctuate the odorants with frequencies up to 70 hertz. So these coherence plots show the temporal resolution of the odorant stimuli. And one important aspect is, or property is, that you can take different odorants which differ in volatility and differ in their stickiness to all the internal materials of an olfactometer, which low pass to a different degree these odorant stimuli. And if you apply these fluctuating odorants, so these traces show six different odorants, the temporal resolution is very similar. So this odor delivery device, I brought the heart of this. This is a polyether ether ketone body, which we equip with fast switching valves, and everybody can easily build this thing. So we supply in this paper, we provide all the plans to cut mill this. It allows highly precise and from setup to setup highly reproducible odorant stimuli. Okay, so first we wanted to know whether insects can use odorant onset asynchrony to segregate odorants. And we did this experiment in honeybees because it's very easy to ask a honeybee whether she smells a certain odorant. And the logic or the experiment was as follows. We trained the honeybees to an odorant A to recognize this odorant. And then we tested the same honeybee with three mixtures of this odorant. So we mixed this odorant A with a novel odorant B. And we either presented this mixture as a synchronous mixture, where the onset was simultaneously of these two odorants, or we shifted the onsets of the two odorants by just 6 milliseconds. And perhaps you see this little shift. So this is true to scale. The odorant stimulus is 800 milliseconds long, and this little shift in the onset is 6 milliseconds. And how do we ask a bee, do you smell odorant A? We do a classical conditioning, and this is shown here in this movie. So the odor is presented to the bee, then we feature some sugar, and bees learn to respond to an odor within one trial. So very quickly, if you want to make them discriminate different odorants, you need just 3 trials, yeah? And then 60% or so of the bees would discriminate. And this is then the performance in the test after they learned that odor A is good. 50% of the bees responded to the synchronous mixture, and 70% roughly responded to these asynchronous mixtures. And one important finding was that it doesn't matter whether this mixture started with the rewarded odor A, to which they responded, or whether it started with a novel odorant. This data looks as if bees can use this asynchrony in the onsets of the odorant to segregate these two odorants. Yes, please.
You basically do these test trials. Essentially, you get one assay per bee when you present the mixture. You're not rewarding them for their choice.
Yeah. Exactly. So this every bee was stimulated with each of these 3 stimuli once. So each bee received first 3 training trials and then 3 test trials. But each bee got a different, the sequence was permeated, as was the identity of the odorant. So this experiment was controlled with respect to the odorant and the sequence. And so bees show extinction. If you present these odorants over and over, they will learn that these odorants are not associated with sugar, but this extinction is rather slow. So.
Yeah, exactly.
It could, it could be, but we don't see the learning. So this extinction learning, we don't see it in this data. Because we randomized the sequence. Yeah, but if I would present one odor again and again, the response probability would go down to 0 after a while. I didn't test it. So I used, this was like a preliminary experiment. I did another experiment where I varied something else, but not the concentration. Yeah. So these concentrations are in the dynamic range of receptor neuron activity. So it's diluted 1 to 1,000 in liquid, and we know that we are not saturating the receptor neurons. So. So we tested this in Drosophila, how mixtures interact at the receptor level, and also within one sensillum, these different neurons which are housed in one sensillum, how they interact with each other, and we don't find a strong effect. But I can give you more details to this later. More questions? Okay, so then we proceeded. First I want to say that it's not only bees who can do it. There are several invertebrate species which are capable to separate odorants either through spatial cues or temporal cues. All these animals, they have exposed olfactory organs, which are in direct contact with the air. What I found extremely exciting here, that 2 days ago we learned from Tim Holy that even mice probably could solve this task, because The spatial arrangement of odorants is mapped onto a spatial map in the nasal epithelium. So that probably would allow mice to use the spatial information to do an odor segregation. And we learned from Andreas Schäfer that mice can are also sensitive for high frequency temporal stimulus information. So I think these results are, I mean, at least for me, super exciting. No, but I saw how sad you were when this disappeared, so I thought I save it for your children and grandchildren. Okay, but now we want to know how much of this temporal information is actually available for the insect. So we recorded the temporal position of insect olfactory receptor neurons. Before I show you the data, I want to make a claim. So receptor neurons in insects, I have to introduce perhaps them quickly. So this is Drosophila, and the following data which I will show you is all Drosophila data. So Drosophila smell with their antennae. These are the antennae. They are covered with sensilla, and each sensillum houses 2 or 3 or 4 receptor neurons. The good thing is you can identify them all. It's very easy to find the same receptor neuron again and again. And this is the way how odor coding is normally quantified. You look at a population of receptor neurons. So this is work by Marine de Bruyne. You give an odorant, and then you calculate the spike rate of a window of 500 milliseconds or any window. Yeah. So, and then you see that each odorant activates a particular pattern of spike rates across those receptor neurons. Yeah. And these patterns allow us very well to identify any odorant. So one could think that these spike rate differences across receptor neurons encode the odorant identity. But the disadvantage of such a rate code is that it takes a lot of time to be being read out. Yeah, so an odorant, two types of receptor neurons, odorant comes, receptor neurons change their rate. In order to read out the rate code, you have to integrate over at least 2 spikes. So the rate and also the precision with which these neurons produce these changes in spike rates then limits the temporal resolution of the odor code. But there are faster ways to encode information in the nervous system. You could just look or integrate over a small time window so that you, so me, I'm the postsynaptic neuron now, and look which neuron populations fire in synchrony within a given time window. Such a synchrony code is limited by the jitter with which these receptor neurons generate their spikes. Another way to encode odorants is by looking at these relative patterns of first spike latencies, and Andreas Schäfer modeled this and showed that this is a feasible coding scheme even for mice. Again, the temporal resolution of such a coding scheme is limited by the temporal precision. Yeah, so in fact, all coding schemes are limited by the temporal precision of spike time generation. So, what is the temporal precision? That has never been directly measured in insects. One could think that insect receptor neurons are super fast because first they are exposed. So this is one sensillum of a Drosophila. So you see these little holes perhaps. They are in direct contact with the air. Odorant molecules diffuse through these holes. They diffuse through the dendrites of the receptor neuron. And then they directly open channels. Yeah, so this is the transduction process in insects. It could potentially be very fast. And so we wanted to know how fast is this process. So previous studies indicated that the minimum response latency of an insect receptor neuron is 10 milliseconds. Some other claimed that it's 30 milliseconds, so not very fast. Okay, how did we address this question. So what is the speed of odor transduction and what is the temporal precision of odor transduction? We did paired recordings from the same receptor neuron type in different sensilla by poking in tungsten electrodes into sensilla of the same type. Then you get these action potential traces, so you can identify receptor neurons based on the heights of their action potentials. And then we presented a very fast odor pulse in order to mimic the situation that an insect is flying through a narrow odorant filament. So our odorant stimulus had a rise time of 3.6 milliseconds, so rise time from 5 to 95% of the signal, of the stimulus. So this is the method. This is some data. So these raster plots show action potentials recorded in the one neuron and in the other neuron, so same receptor neuron type in one fly, to 10 repeats of these odorant stimuli. Here we used methylbutyrate at a concentration of 10 to the minus 5, so diluted in a solvent, mineral oil, 10 to the minus 4, 10 to minus 3. Scale bar is 100 milliseconds. So what you see is, as you increase the concentration, these spikes, they tightly phase lock or tightly lock to the stimulus. Okay, from this data, we first measured the response latency, so the time between arrival of the odorant and the generation of the first spike. On the x-axis, you see the concentrations. So we started with blank air, and then we presented the odorant concentrations, different odorant concentrations, so increasing concentrations. So these are log orders of concentration. Note that the y-scale shows the response latency in milliseconds. It's a log scale. So if you use very high concentrations, you get very short response latencies. So the median response latencies are depicted here. So 2.5 milliseconds, for example, at a high concentration of methylbutyrate. If you record in these AB2A neurons, for example, these different points show the data from the single neurons. Okay, this shows that odor transduction can be very, very fast. Then we wanted to know how precise is it. And in order to quantify the precision, we took the standard deviation of the first spike latencies. And we call this jitter. So this is also given in milliseconds. And again, these numbers here, they show the median jitter values over different animals, different neurons. And we find that as you increase the concentration, the jitter goes down to below a millisecond. So odor transduction is not only fast, it's also temporally very precise. And this is, in fact, in the range of the jitter of mechanosensory or visual neurons. So it's not much slower or not much less precise than these temporally very precise mechanical or even auditory receptor neurons. Yes? Not much. I will show this data for different odorants. It does not differ much. Pardon? I could speak up. Yes, I will also show this, that we can use this. Okay, now we want to compare it with the rate changes. In order to make it better comparable with these millisecond time scales, I plot here not the rate, but the inverse rate, so which means the interval between two consecutive spikes. And what we found is that so first, at highest concentration, we have the shortest interval between two spikes, 3 milliseconds. That corresponds to 330 spikes per second. And the interesting thing is that these changes in rate, they vary over a lower range of concentration. Yeah, they vary over three orders log orders of magnitude. Various the first spike latency or the jitter varies over at least one or two log orders larger range. So you are more sensitive if you could use this timing information at the lower concentrations, and you don't saturate as quickly at the higher concentrations. Yeah? So there is more, at least odorant concentration information contained in the spike, in the precise spike timing, than in the rates. And so to demonstrate that this precise spike timing is not an artifact of super high odorant concentration, I highlight here a concentration 10 to the minus 4, where we just see a significant response change or change in the rate, yeah? And we find a temporal position of 2.14 milliseconds already, and a response latency of 10 milliseconds, which is short. Pardon? Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's the maximum spike rate. So we looked during the stimulus and took the maximum spike rate, and here then depicted as the minimum interspike interval. But we find the same if we take just the interval between the first and the second spike. It gets really worse if we integrate over 100 milliseconds, so take the average rate. Then we lose dynamic range massively. Yeah. Okay. Oh, Dima.
If you talk about this, I'm really curious because for the you see the jitter increases with the latency increases, but so what's the scalability? Are you going to talk about this?
Yes, a little bit. Not yeah. I will show some data perhaps which will answer your question. Yes? Population rates, you mean across different neuron populations? I will show it also, yeah. Okay. So the cool thing, what you can do in Drosophila, which you cannot do in mice, is the following calculation. So we know exactly how this circuit is the architecture of the circuit. So thanks to work from Bill Hansen's and Silke Sachs' lab, we know that there are exactly 23 of those AB2A neurons. So the data I showed you came from these neurons. We know from their work is that they project onto one projection neuron in this glomerulus. And we know from Kazama's and Wilson's lab, Rachel Wilson's lab, that all receptor neurons make contact to this projection neuron, or the other way around, perhaps. Each projection neuron in the Drosophila glomerulus gets input from all receptor neurons. So we know the convergence rate, which is here 23:1. This now allows us to estimate what is the minimum time window a readout neuron, so projection neuron, which would be the analog to a midbrain cell. What is the minimum time window of integration time needed to discriminate odor-evoked spikes from spontaneously generated spikes? We did it by just counting the number of spikes across these 23 neurons in a given time window. Let's say 1 millisecond, we get a distribution. So we have perhaps mean number of spikes, so let's say 70 spikes, and a standard deviation. And we do the same for a 1 millisecond time window before the stimulus. And we get also a mean spike number and a distribution. And then in order to quantify the distance between, or the separability between the odorant-evoked spikes and the spontaneously generated spikes. We just take the difference in these two means between the odorant and spontaneous spikes and normalize it by the standard deviation. So this is a common measure, which is called sensitivity index. Rachel Wilson used it to do exactly such a calculation. She called it detection accuracy. So it's a measure for how well you can separate two signals. These integration time windows, we were sliding over the time, in order to see how does integration time or odorant information changes over time. We took the real data, we shuffled it, and we always picked like 23, but it's, yeah, so it's a real data-based simulation. So if we make this time window, for example, 32 milliseconds long, we count the number of spikes in 32 milliseconds, and then measure the distance to the spontaneously evoked spikes in a 32 millisecond time window counted before the stimulus, then we see that, so this is this magenta line, that like after 7 milliseconds or so, we cross a threshold of 2, which would mean that our signal is like 2 times larger than the standard deviation of the noise, yeah? So you can express it like it simplified like this. And then it increases as you slide your window forward. The interesting thing is you can make your integration time windows very short, yeah? So if you look at the black trace, this is this signal detection accuracy if you have just a 1 millisecond time window. You also reach within the same time this threshold of 2 detection accuracy units. It does not go as high, but I mean, I would think we don't need this high certainty as a readout neuron that there was an odorant. Probably 2 standard deviations above noise is probably enough. And the interesting thing now is that in a time window of 1 millisecond, a maximum of 1 spikes fit per neuron. Yeah, because neurons have a refractory period, so they need at least 2 milliseconds, let's say, to generate a next spike. So that means that a purely spike timing-based code, so if you just count the number of spikes in a very narrow time window after your odorant stimulus, is enough to extract a lot of odorant information. Here we wanted to know what is the minimum time window now, the minimum integration time window a readout neuron would need in order to cross this 2 standard deviation threshold. And we found ridiculously short integration time windows. So at the highest concentration, you just need 10 microseconds to be certain that there was an odor, yeah? And even at concentrations, 10 to the minus 6, perhaps now I should switch to the next slide. So, sorry, it looks a bit different, but this is now the same stimulus detection concentration dependency, what I just showed on the previous slide. So, very short time windows are only needed for high concentrations. And now if we look at a concentration of 10 to the minus 6, where we don't see any signature of an odorant in the rate, if we just look at the rate, we see already that 4.4 milliseconds of integration time is enough to detect this odorant. And then with the next highest concentration, you are already in a time window where only one neuron fits in, where there's no need to read out the rates at any concentration, actually.
This is supposed to detect the presence of the odorant.
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Yeah. And I mean, I really like Dima's primacy code. I mean, these methylbutyrate for this is not the best ligand for this receptor neuron. Yeah, so if you would take the best ligand, you would get even shorter times. Yeah, and then if only 6 glomeruli would be sufficient to encode any given odorant, odorant detection identity identification could happen in no time. Yes, but I have to show you the circuit. I don't show it in the talk, but later I want to show it. I think it's possible. So odorants are encoded in in a combinatorial pattern. So and here I want to give an impression of the spatial or combinatorial pattern of activity if we take timing. So we recorded from two receptor neuron types. This is the AB2A neuron, which I showed the data, and the AB3A neuron. What I plotted here is all the data we had actually for the first spike latencies for two different odorants. So the green is the methylbutyrate, which I just showed, magenta ethyl acetate, and the different concentrations. And you have to read this plot as follows. So if you look at this box, ethyl acetate at a concentration of 10 to the minus 3. This line here, the horizontal line, shows the median first spike latency of the AB2A neuron. So it responds after around 6 milliseconds. Yeah, and the boxes show the 5 to 95 percentile. Percentile range. AB2A responds after 6 milliseconds, AB3A after perhaps 20 milliseconds. So what you see here is that if you like go from up to down, so from low concentration to high concentration, the response latencies become shorter. First, what you also see is that each odor evokes a specific sequence of response latencies. So the AB2A neuron only always responds a little bit quicker to ethyl acetate as does the AB3A neuron. And for methylbutyrate, it's the other way around. So odorant identity could be encoded in the order of receptor neuron activation. So whenever there's an odorant that first activates AB2A and then AB3A, it's more likely to be ethyl acetate than methylbutyrate. So this is what this slide shows you. And the order is odorant specific, but it's invariant to concentration. So even though the latencies, they vary over two orders of magnitude, the order stays stable, concentration invariant. For different odorants?
Yeah.
I don't know. I only tested these odorants here, so we have.
But the data exists.
Yeah, but. Nah, he did calcium imaging.
Yeah.
He has no spike data. So I. And from this data, I cannot estimate the response latencies.
Yeah.
Or did I? I think I didn't get your question fully.
I guess I'm asking you to do more experiments. Galicia has this, this, I think it's for AB3A, but he has a whole spread of 24 ligands where he has some of the sense of their efficacy highly sensitive to less sensitive. So you could do it for that to see how many molecules can you identify using this.
Yeah. But you have to then also take into account all the other or many other receptor neurons. But I have to do the experiment. So first I have to present all the other odorants and test. With
I mean, just the basic question: you give an ester to an odorant that can respond to 24 esters. How is it used at this very compressed time?
Yeah.
Get down to nanoseconds.
Yeah.
In a sense, what each receptor sort of contributes is its latency. by the sort of just like a first order kinetic model would suggest that each lake is on this log plot is a linear slope, and they're all different relative to one another.
Yeah.
And it's the relative position of the receptor gene that determines the primary model.
Okay. So now let's compare this with an rate code performance. So again, what is shown here is the minimum interspike interval. And one thing which stands out is that these patterns are highly correlated. Yeah. So a neuron which fires with a high rate to one odorant also has short response latency. So there's a high correlation in these across neuron patterns. But what we see is that a rate code couldn't discriminate so well over a wide concentration range. Okay. Yes. So this is just a slide which summarizes the work I did with Brian Smith and Rick Gürken in Tempe, where we tried to measure the response latency and the pulse tracking capability of insect antennae. So we chopped off insect antennae of different insect species and found that they could respond to highly concentrated odorants in this case within a few milliseconds. So this fits to the data we got from Drosophila. I didn't show you data showing how well spikes can follow repetitive pulses, but we found that Drosophila receptor neurons, they can resolve up to 125 pulses per second as a population. And the same is true for these electroentonogram responses, where we record from a huge population of receptor neurons. So in general, odor transduction in insects is very fast and has a high temporal resolution. Okay, so summary and conclusion. How much time do I have? Ah, super. Okay, then we have time for discussion. Okay, so summary. So we found short first spike latencies of less than 3 milliseconds. We found that the jitter can be less than a millisecond. We found that stimulus detection could happen within less than 20 microseconds. We have to prove that projection neurons are sensitive, actually, that they can discriminate or have short integration time. So this will be my next project, but I don't have data. I don't even have the setup for this yet. So what are the conclusions? First, which is trivial, synchrony across receptor neurons reliably encodes the onset of an odorant stimulus. So when there is synchronous activity across receptor neurons, the olfactory system should know that there was an odorant just right now or a few milliseconds before. We found that the latency and also the degree of synchrony or the jitter of the first spike latencies encodes odorant concentration. We found that the order of first spike latencies across receptor neurons encodes odorant identity. And importantly, is concentration invariant. And to conclude further, we think that the olfactory system could use temporal coding scheme for fluctuating odorant stimuli. And because it is so highly correlated with these patterns of rates, the olfactory system could actually use both. It could use a rate code for more static odorant stimuli and could switch between temporal or rate codes depending on the environment in which it just is. And then what I at least find exciting is that a first spike latency code, where the sequence or the order of receptor neuron activities and code odor identity is very well suited to do rapid odorant detection, which would allow odorant source separation just because it's fast. Yeah. Yes, that's it. I want to acknowledge, first of all, Alpha Renner and Alex Egea-Weiss, two bachelor students, and all these double recordings and data analysis were their bachelor theses. So they came into the lab completely untrained. They got Drosophila and set up, and this is, again, a beauty of Drosophila, that you can do these experiments very easily. Together with Georg Reiser, we developed this odor delivery device, which I want to advertise. Giovanni Galizia houses me, so I'm an independent scientist, but a little bit dependent because he provides me lab space. He's a great colleague for discussion. Christoph Klein-Eidam was also involved in these single sensillum recordings. And then, thanks to my HFSP grant team, Thomas Novotny, Brian Smith, and Ryo Hekansaki, we are trying to develop robots which can do odor background segregation, which are equipped with moth antennae, which are genetically modified so that they are responding to single odorants only. And thanks for your attention.